The Bible is often criticised as unreliable.
We often hear that its message cannot be trusted. There is one group of men in particular that we can blame for this generally alleged unreliability of the Bible. And that group of men are known as the higher critics. And what I want to do with this afternoon is just to look at the work of the higher critics, to learn a little bit more about what they say or said, and to understand that archaeology is just one way in which these men and women have been shown to be foolishly wrong. There are many ways in which the Bible can be shown to be reliable and true. And this afternoon I just want to look at one of those with you and to think about the damage that has been done in the popular mind by these men known as the higher critics. Now, the phrase higher critics might be new to you. You might have heard it and you might wonder, who are the higher critics? And what I want to do, just briefly, is to answer that question and to just review what the higher critics had to say for themselves, so that we ourselves can be alive to their arguments whenever we come across them in whatever form they happen to come across to us, so that we learn how to recognise them and beware of them and know that they can be answered. So, why do we need to bother about them at all? The first thing I think that has to be said about the higher critics is that they come in all shapes and sizes. They don't come up to you with a badge that says, I am a higher critic, beware of me, or don't believe what I say. It's not like that. They don't wear badges, and very few, if any, of the higher critics in the world today actually call themselves higher critics. They don't use that term in general. But that doesn't mean they don't exist. In fact, these days, they tend to call themselves much fancier terms than that. They call themselves source critics. But source as in O-U-R-C-E, not A-U-C-E. You understand what I mean? They call themselves form critics. Or they call themselves, even posher, redaction critics. But when you pick up and read a Bible commentary, almost any commentary published in the second half of the 20th century and the first part of the 21st century, it won't have a health cover on the warning that a health warning on the cover that says, beware, this book was written by a redaction critic or a form critic or a source critic. Or when you hear a TV producer and announcer together, or when you read a so-called expert writing something about the Bible, they won't tell you up front that their approach to the Bible is a higher critical one. They won't do that. They just take it for granted that that's normal. And yet if we are going to read our Bibles objectively, if we are going to give God a chance to speak to us openly through the pages of this book, then we need to be on our guard against a hypercritical approach, and we need to be able to recognise these critics in all their different forms. And to do that, we need to be able to recognise their arguments against a divinely inspired Bible. We need to be sure that there is always an answer to them. So what is this so-called higher criticism? Where did it come from? And what should we know about it? Bit of history to start with. The term higher criticism was first used to identify a particular school of negative biblical criticism that arose in the theology department of the University of Tübingen in Germany during the first half of the 19th century. So it's been around a long time. I'll say more about Tübingen in a moment when I start naming some names. But for the moment, I just want to paint a broad brush picture of higher criticism. Because in fact, during the second half of the 19th century, as the pernicious influence of the Tübingen school of theology began to spread, the term higher criticism came gradually to describe all the different types of biblical criticism that treat the Bible as a work of purely human origin. And sad to say, that same view of the Bible still pervades both the scholarly and the popular approach to the reading and understanding of the Bible in our day, to the point where, this is where we're at now, where belief in the inspiration of the Bible as the Word of God has become very unfashionable indeed, to say the least. So why do we need to know, if it isn't already obvious? The main reason why we need to know about the higher critics is because they have been largely responsible for undermining and almost entirely eliminating general public confidence and belief in the Bible as the Word of God. It's vital, therefore, if we are going to approach the Bible with an open mind, that we should know about these Bible critics and their methods. For unless our faith in God is going to be entirely blind, we really ought to be able to know that our faith in God is soundly based on the inspiration and reliability of His Word. We owe it to ourselves to know with confidence that even the most apparently learned experts can easily be wrong, as they often are. It should actually help to bolster and strengthen faith in God to know that the Bible really is His Word. In fact, I would go so far as to say that it may be because Bible believers don't generally know enough about the mistakes of the higher critics, and there are many of them, and because by and large these critics don't get tackled often and vigorously enough, that their destructive conclusions have made such inroads into the public consciousness and in the process have overthrown the faith of so many people. It is a sad state of affairs. Like many things in the world around us today, it is a deplorable state of affairs. It's been well described by Sir Charles Marston in his book, The Bible is True. The complete assurance with which many higher critics wrote has been entirely unjustified. Yet the mass of people have thought that the higher criticism, since it was endorsed and advocated even by distinguished bishops, could be taken for granted as giving correct results. The effect of such grave errors upon Christianity in general have been devastating. So who are, or who were, the original higher critics? This is where we start to walk into the rogues gallery. Looking back from the early 21st century, we can now see how this process of gradually undermining the divine origin and truthfulness of the Bible began in earnest in 19th century Germany with scholars like this man, Ferdinand Bauer. Bauer was a German theologian who founded the Tübingen School of Theology and who tried to prove, inverted commas, among many other erroneous things, that the Apostle Paul did not write the pastoral epistles that bear his name in our Bibles. That was his life's work, to prove those letters are not Paul's. Then we come on to a man called Julius Wellhausen. Wellhausen was a biblical scholar and Oriental linguist who established himself as a professor in Göttingen University and who has two chief claims to fame, or perhaps I should say infamy. First, Wellhausen tried to prove that the first six books of the Bible, the Hexateuch, were made up of four different texts, none of which were written by Moses. This is what is known generally as the documentary hypothesis, and we hear a lot about it in modern commentaries on the Old Testament. It was also Wellhausen who made the foolish claim that Moses couldn't possibly have written the Pentateuch, because he claimed that writing was not invented until after the time of Moses. In other words, Wellhausen tried to show that Moses was illiterate. But more of that later. Then we come on to Friedrich Delitzsch. Delitzsch was a German Assyriologist who first claimed that the idea of primitive man worshipping one God was nonsense. In his controversial book, Babel and Bible, published in 1902, Delitzsch also set out to prove that the Genesis creation account was borrowed directly from Babylonian culture during the Israelites' captivity in the 6th century BC. De Litch's writings also frequently attack the Old Testament for its so-called inaccuracies. Heinrich Ewald was a German theologian and Orientalist at both Göttingen and Tübingen universities. He is the scholar who found what he said were convincing linguistic reasons for assigning the book of Daniel to the post-exilic Maccabean era, that is about 400 years later than Daniel claimed to be written, according to the standard view. There were many others too from the same period of German academic scholarship, most of them influenced by the Tübingen school, who all added something to the mass of higher critical material that poured out of Germany during the 19th century. And sad to say, those critical German scholars had a pronounced influence elsewhere in Europe, as a direct result of which there's also a rogues gallery of British scholars who embraced these spurious and liberal views, especially amongst university-educated clergymen, who wanted to make a display of their advanced learning and scholarship by adopting and spreading the fashionable ideas of the German schools of theology and criticism. And among those in England who swallowed the higher criticism were quite a few high churchmen, men who should have known better, men like Arthur Stanley, the influential Dean of Westminster, who embraced just about every liberal idea that was floating about during the 19th century. A man who did perhaps more than any other single man of the cloth in England to undermine a simple faith in the Word of God. Dean Stanley was also very quick to defend this man, Bishop Colenso, a man who had unorthodox views that were called into question by his own church, the Church of England. John Colenso was a really controversial Anglican churchman. He was what you might call the Bishop of Woolwich of the 19th century. He was accused of heresy by the church. And perhaps no surprise either that, like Dean Stanley, Bishop Colenso also embraced higher critical views, in particular, in his case, about the Pentateuch, which he said could not possibly have been the work of Moses. And then along came Canon Driver, an Oxford professor of Hebrew who swallowed the higher critical theories wholesale, and who then passed them on systematically to a whole new generation of younger scholars who sat at his feet in Oxford. Canon Driver edited both the Cambridge Bible Commentary and the Oxford Clarendon Bible series, and that fact makes many of those widely circulated volumes seriously flawed from our point of view. And the theory for which Canon Driver is perhaps most well known is the divided Isaiah theory, which I'll come on to a little bit later. And so it was, sadly, that in the academic world, the acceptance of higher critical theories and methods became almost a test of your scholarship and orthodoxy. It's a sad example of the emperor's new clothes phenomenon, in which there's no room for any dissent, and because of which a very high proportion of the books and articles written during the 20th century, including Bible commentaries, handbooks and dictionaries, became infected by the higher critical approach. That's how it came to pass. Even more sad is the fact that the general public just followed the scholars like sheep, so that these days it's almost taken for granted that the Bible is the uninspired and unreliable word of men. That view, in fact, is virtually now an urban myth. Almost everybody believes it, even though it isn't true. And because the urban myth has now become the received wisdom, it makes it quite an uphill task to try to counteract the effect of a century and a half of negative criticism. I want to look at some of the ways in which the higher critical theories about the Bible can be shown to be wrong by the evidence of archaeology. But before we do that, I want to explain just a little bit more clearly just what higher criticism is and why it's called higher and what particular areas of Bible study it affects. It's perhaps an obvious thing to say, but it is the case that the term higher presupposes that there is a lower. So here's a dictionary definition of the distinction between the two, the higher and the lower criticism. Yeah, and that was perfect when I looked at it before, so excuse the spacing. This is the definition from Chambers' Encyclopedia. The term higher criticism has reference not to any pretended superiority, it is concerned with questions of date and authorship, unity and literary structure, the sources used and historical media reflected in the books of the Bible. That's a neat summary of what higher criticism is. The lower criticism is concerned with the history of the text after it left the hands of the author or compiler and seeks to recover the original form of the text. In other words, the lower criticism concerns itself with identifying any errors of copying, errors of transmission, which may have crept into the text since it was first written down. That's the work of linguists and of paleographers, people who work on the text. And there is generally little to fear from people like that, since the lower or textual criticism very rarely challenges faith in the Bible's reliability. The higher criticism, on the other hand, really does set out to make categorical statements about things which impact directly on many basic beliefs about the Bible. Issues of authorship, issues of meaning, issues of authenticity, of accuracy, and of reliability of the actual text itself. Sometimes called historicity, a truth as a matter of historical fact. So here's a family tree of Bible criticism. The higher critics approach their task from two basic points of view, which are represented here. The lower criticism relates to textual matters. The higher criticism is basically literary and historical. And to illustrate this, I've chosen a typical sample of five cases where the higher critics have proved to be completely wrong on the evidence of archaeology. Five examples only, with three of them coming under the heading of literary higher criticism and two under the heading of historical higher criticism. And in all these cases, we'll see very clearly how dishonest and how wrong the higher critics have been in their destructive tasks and their attacks on the Bible. So here they are, set out against this original diagram. First, in the literary category, there's the question of the authorship of the Pentateuch, whether or not it was written by Moses, or could have been written by Moses. Secondly, I want to look at the dating of Daniel's prophecy. Was it written in 600 BC or 200 BC? Then I want to look at the authorship of Isaiah's prophecy. Was it written by one Isaiah, or two, or possibly even more, as some critics have gone on to say. And then under the historical heading, we look at what the higher critics said about Genesis chapter 14, and you'll see when we look at it why that's important. And then finally, I want to look at just a few of what the higher critics claimed were legendary accounts in the Bible, things that they pointed to and said, not true, never existed, never happened. We shall see. So first, let's take the question of the authorship of the Pentateuch. It was our old friend Julius Wellhausen who boldly stated in the 1870s that the first few books of the Bible couldn't possibly have been written by Moses, since he lived at a primitive era of human history when writing was unknown. That gives us a useful insight into the higher critical methods, since this is a case of what was then an argument from silence. There was no evidence either way, so they presumed that the Bible was unreliable. At the time when Wellhausen first made this false claim, there was no archaeological evidence of writing before the year 800 BC, which is the classical Greek period. So, argument from silence. And Wellhausen's influence across Europe at the time was such that when Robertson Smith, the editor of the Encyclopaedia Britannica, no less, when he came to write the entry on the Bible in the 9th edition of the Encyclopedia in 1881, he included Wellhausen's theory in the Encyclopedia as if it were a well-established fact of history. So if you bought your 1881 Encyclopaedia Britannica and you looked up the Bible, you would see that the experts were telling you it wasn't written, the Pentateuch wasn't written before 800 BC. Couldn't have been written by Moses. Moses didn't write. Now it appears entirely providential that in the late 1800s, Oriental archaeology was being put on a much more scientific and rigorous basis, particularly through the work of the Palestine Exploration Fund and the Egyptian Exploration Society, and with more and more professional archaeologists working on properly funded official excavations. And what did they find? It was thanks to the work of professional archaeologists like Conder, Warren, and Flinders Petrie, building on the slightly earlier discoveries of anthropologists and explorers like Rawlinson and Layard, that the date of the invention of writing was put back to at least 3000 BC. Never mind 800 BC, let's think about 3000 BC, and possibly even earlier. And this new knowledge was based on materials like this. This is a Sumerian clay tablet dating from around 2600 BC and predating Abraham by at least six centuries. Never mind Moses, this predates Abraham by six centuries at least. And here is a cuneiform tablet from a vast library dating from around 2500 BC. Here's a tablet from the Tel El Amarna archive of the Egyptian pharaoh Akhenaten, dating from the 2nd millennium BC, quite close in fact, to the time of Moses. Writing not invented? I should think so. Now, to their credit, there were a number of biblical scholars who refused to wear the emperor's new clothes, and who accepted the growing volume of archaeological evidence that supported an early date for the invention of writing. But quite perversely, most German scholars and many English higher critics continued to think that Wellhausen was basically correct in his hypothesis that Moses couldn't have written and didn't write the first five books of Moses. Wellhausen's theory, and it is a theory, known as the documentary hypothesis, took the view that the Pentateuch was cobbled together at different times by various groups of Jewish priests many years after Moses had passed off the scene. The hypothesis itself about the composite, non-Mosaic authorship of the Pentateuch has no scientific or objective or rational basis in fact. And yet it still infects just about every modern Bible commentary. In that respect, Wellhausen's theory is like Darwin's theory of evolution. It's unproved and unprovable. And yet most people take it for granted that it's true, even though it isn't. So much for Wellhausen. What about the dating of Daniel, the second example of a higher critical argument that has been discredited? This was a critical attack that was first made by Heinrich Ewald. He based his later dating of Daniel, on Daniel's use in the text of certain Greek-sounding words for musical instruments. There are quite a lot of musical instruments in the earlier chapters of Daniel. All that bowing down to the image, for example, and worshipping Nebuchadnezzar, all of that kind of stuff was accompanied by musical instruments. When you heard the sound of this, that, and the other, bow down. And they look like Greek words or Greek forms of words. And it was on that basis, tenuous as it is, that Ewald said, this can't be dating from 600 BC when Daniel lived. It must be a lot later because these instruments didn't penetrate into the Middle East until the year 200 BC. And if the atheistic critics could show that Daniel wasn't written until many centuries after it seems to have been written, then it would help to remove the miraculous nature of the book's claims to have been inspired by God in relation to the prophecies that it contains. Daniel chapter 11, for example, has got a prophecy about the development of Alexander's empire. If it was written afterwards, obviously it was because people knew what had already happened. Whereas if it was written earlier, then it was prophetic and it came true. So it's really quite an important issue. So here's the list of the Greek terms that Ewald said proved that the book of Daniel couldn't have been written until the time of the Maccabees, 400 years after the time of the biblical Daniel. What does archaeology now tell us about the true facts of this particular case? You recognise some of these from Daniel chapter 3 and Daniel chapter 7. And these terms on the left are supposedly got Greek influence. They do have Greek influence. Well, first of all, we learn from inscriptions and carvings like this one, which is from Sennacherib's palace at Nineveh, which was unearthed during the 19th century, that there was, in fact, cultural contact on an extensive scale between Greece and the Middle East as early as the 8th century BC. So you're talking 700 BC. Sennacherib actually conquered a Greek army early in his reign. And Greek merchants are now known to have traded with the Fertile Crescent as early as the 6th century BC when Daniel was in Babylon. So the existence of musical instruments showing Greek influences in the book of Daniel is actually an evidence of its genuineness rather than a proof that it was written much later. In fact, subsequent archaeological and linguistic discoveries have shown that a number of the words that Daniel used for particular musical instruments on that list had actually changed or fallen out of use by the year 200 BC, at the date when Ewald claimed that Daniel was written. In other words, Daniel used exactly the words that were appropriate to the time at which the book was written by Daniel. And the higher critic was left, as so often, with egg on his face. Moving on then to our third example of a direct attack on the scriptures by the higher critics, and that's the issue of the authorship of the prophecy of Isaiah. Taking his cue from Bellhausen, the same Robertson Smith who edited the Encyclopaedia Britannica and who mistakenly wrote that Moses couldn't write, he also claimed in 1882 that the book of Isaiah was actually the work of two different writers who lived at least 400 years apart. They're just making it up. This was the so-called Deutero-Isaiah theory. If you have a theory that doesn't stand up, give it a fancy name and people will catch on. The Deutero-Isaiah theory. Eagerly swallowed and developed by many subsequent biblical scholars, including Canon Driver, who included it in his influential book on Isaiah in 1890. The funny thing is, though, that whereas Smith thought that the break between the two Isaiahs came at the end of chapter 33, Driver thought that the break came at the end of chapter 39. So they spent half their careers arguing about that case. And the scholars have been arguing about it ever since. And they're still arguing about it. There are some biblical scholars today who think that Isaiah may have had three authors. And there's even now a Scandinavian school of theology which has rediscovered the single authorship of the whole book, as though that was something new. What does archaeology have to say? Well, of course, you recognise this picture as being Qumran. And to start with, among the Dead Sea Scrolls found at Qumran in the late 1940s, there are no fewer than 19 copies of the book of Isaiah, two of which are complete. And both of those copies show the book of Isaiah in an undivided state, from chapters 1 to 66, just as we have it in our Bibles now. This scroll, known as the Great Isaiah Scroll, has been dated fairly accurately to shortly after 200 BC. In other words, this is a copy made about 500 years after the time when the prophet Isaiah lived. 500 years after. And it's all in one piece. It has no breaks or distinctions between chapters 33 and 34, or between chapter 39 and chapter 40, such as you might have expected to find if part 2 of Isaiah had been written 600 years after part 1. And yet there's even more to it than that amazing discovery. Because an honest and objective appraisal of the language of Isaiah, chapters 40 to 66, the so-called imagined second half of Isaiah, or second writing of Isaiah, it shows that there are no Hebrew words, no Hebrew phrases, no Hebrew constructions used in any of those later chapters that are later in date than those which are used in chapters 1 to 39. And they are all consistent with an 8th century date of writing. Funny that, isn't it? And the so-called change of style between the two sections is based entirely on subjective opinion. Changes of style are found in virtually all documents of any length. They usually occur when the writer is dealing with different subject matter. It's what we find throughout Isaiah. You can find similar changes of style in Shakespeare's plays. That doesn't prove that there were two or three, or perhaps even more, William Shakespeares. It's just a natural thing. The High Critics have built a house of cards with arguments that stand on very flimsy ground, yet again. So after those three examples of literary higher criticism, let's look at two examples from historical higher criticism. Because here again, we'll see how the evidence of archaeology has proved the critics wrong. First of these examples is about the historicity of Genesis 14, a chapter which the higher critics freely attacked. Genesis 14 contains an account of Abraham's conflict with four kings from the east of Canaan. And that's an account that was fiercely attacked by the high critics as what they called one of the most unhistorical and inaccurate parts of Scripture. That's a big claim, isn't it? The kings mentioned in the opening verses of Genesis 14 were said never to have existed. Their raids were said to have been impossible. And the record mentions places which the critics rejected as the figment of the writer's imagination. I'm actually quoting there when I say those words. This is actually what the higher critic Julius Wellhausen wrote. That four kings from the Persian Gulf made an incursion into the Sinaitic Peninsula, that they attacked five kinglets on the Dead Sea shore and carried off prisoners, and finally that Abraham set out in pursuit with only 318 manservants and forced them to disgorge their prey, all these incidents are sheer impossibilities. This is one of the leading scholars of German theological and biblical criticism said and wrote. But he wrote all that biased criticism before the discovery of ancient records relating to Hammurabi, Amraphel, including this fragment from about 1950 BC, almost 2000 BC, in which the name of Chedorlaomer, one of the kings mentioned in Genesis 14, appears in the Elamite form Kudurlagamar, pointed out by the arrow. And it's as a result of inscription. Remember, the critics said this king never existed. Here he is, as we say, black and white in whatever you say, you know, inscriptions. And it's because of inscriptions like this that our knowledge of the culture and civilization around the time of Abraham has been completely revolutionized. So much so that no self-respecting scholar now would ever repeat what Wellhausen said about Genesis 14. In fact, the scholars of today are much more likely to agree with the following statement in support of the historicity of Genesis 14. In Genesis 14, said D.J. Wiseman, Abraham is described in terms which accord with the early second millennium. For example, the Genesis 14 incident would hardly have been feasible after 1000 BC. There is nothing inconsistent in the Abrahamic narratives which demands that this is a late interpretation of the patriarch's role. It's quite different, isn't it, what we get today? J.A. Thompson has written, "The fact that there are so many links in the Genesis narratives with the world of the first part of the second millennium BC is inexplicable if the stories of the patriarchs are only the inventions of later days. We are compelled to conclude that the narratives of Genesis 12 to 50 have a solid historical basis." And yet still the high critics have pressed on with their atheistic attacks on the Bible record. And that brings us on to these alleged legendary accounts. Another example of attacks by historical higher critics. The very existence of Sargon, king of Assyria. The murder of his son Sennacherib, related in Isaiah 37. even the fall of Babylon under Belshazzar. Biblical accounts like that once said to be legendary. Yet solid archaeological evidence has been unearthed for every one of these and for hundreds more that could be brought forward. Here, for example, is a magnificent carved head of Sargon, together with a relief portrait, both found in the ruins of Nineveh, proving that Sargon was a very real and certainly not a mythical 8th century ruler of Assyria. Now, nobody doubts Sargon's existence, nor that he was the father of Sennacherib, and the higher critics have been proved wrong once again. As far as Sargon's son Sennacherib himself is concerned, the archaeologists have actually found this ancient inscription about his death. On the 20th day of Tebet, his sons revolted against him and they killed their father Sennacherib. On the 18th day of Sivan, Esarhaddon, his son, became king. And that's exactly what the Bible said in the first place. And here's the text of an inscription found at Ur and dating from the time of Belshazzar's father, Nabonidus. It takes the form of an invocation to the Babylonian gods. And remember, Nabonidus was said in the 19th century by the higher critics to be a myth. May it be that I, Nabonidus, king of Babylon, never fail you, and may my firstborn, Belshazzar, worship you with all his heart. So as far as the historicity of Belshazzar is concerned, he is now a well-attested historical ruler of Babylon, whose short reign of 2 to 3 years ended in the disaster of the fall of Babylon to the Medo-Persians. It's all a bit embarrassing for the higher critics, yet they never seem to give up. So what kind of conclusions can we draw from all of this? Well, perhaps the only good thing we can say that has come out of all the higher critical attacks on the Bible is that they've served to illustrate human ignorance. And they've been a means of helping at least some Bible readers to appreciate and value God's word more highly. It has, after all, made Bible readers take a closer and more intelligent look not only at the text of Scripture, but also at the evidence that lies buried in the earth. What did Job say? Speak to the earth, and it shall teach thee. May have been talking about something else, but it seems very appropriate to me to say archaeology has spoken to us about the truth of the Bible. Yet for the world at large, the spiritual cost has been truly enormous. It reminds us of what the Apostle Peter forecast so long ago, that God would one day send the world a strong delusion that they might believe a lie. For when all is said and done, the work of the higher critics is a pack of lies. Yet most of the world has been taken in by it. What a sad state of affairs it really is. This is a supreme irony, that at a time when there is more tangible evidence for the truth of God's word than at any other time in history, there are fewer and fewer people who are willing to put their trust in the Bible's message and in its saving truth. But my final thought comes as a direct challenge from the lips of Jesus himself in John chapter 5. For as we think about the Bible and the higher critics, I believe that these words of Jesus should act as a bolster to faith in the word of God, and particularly in that most maligned part of scriptures, the books of Moses. These words of Jesus are a direct challenge for those who doubt the authenticity of the writings of Moses. If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote of me. He wrote of me. No doubt in the mind of Jesus. But if you believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words? So who'd believe the higher critics, even if they come dressed as scholarly experts? Not me. They have nothing to teach us but empty falsehoods. And I'll leave you with this reassuring quote from a book called Archaeology Gives Evidence by Rendell Short. The trend of all this increased knowledge from archaeology has been to confirm the authority of the books of the Old Testament. Destructive criticism is thrown on the defensive. This is the important thing for us. The plain man may read his Bible confident that for anything that modern research has to say, the word of our God shall stand forever. Thank you for listening.